So I've just gotten back from Hollywood, and I cannot believe what happened. I cannot believe it, mate.
First off, why did you go to Hollywood?
Oh, in Hollywood, we've got Jack and Henry staying with us, and because Jack's from Sunderland, Henry's is from Wales, we need to do the touristy things. Mm. It's a Sunday afternoon. I thought, take the wife, kids, and them two kids as well. They're both 20-year-old. And so my daughters love Mickey Mouse, Minnie Mouse. Like, all our kids do. And we're seeing Minnie Mouse dressed up. So, oh, I'm going to get a picture. And I'm going to put the picture on, I'll put it on boxandburnpodcast.com/69. This is episode 69.
Ooh.
And now we've got the new episode. So boxandlifepodcast.com/69. I'm going to put this picture on of Minnie Mouse counting a big fat wad of cash. Pete, if you want to see this picture, go there. So my daughter's like, oh, Minnie Mouse, Minnie Mouse, Minnie Mouse. Loving her. I'm like, all right, let's get a picture. You know you've got to pay these people, yeah, right? So I'm taking a picture and all that. And it comes to paying, I've got no dollars. I'm going to give a couple of dollars.
You had no dollars on you?
No dollars. Just had
what's new?
I just had hundreds. No, I had hundreds, fifties. So I come to paying and no one had money on it. You know, so I was like, so Minnie Mouse says to us, yeah, I've got change here. So I give her a 50. She gives us, she says, how much do you want back? I said, I want $47 back. So she gives us two 20s and then the $7. So I'm like, all right, son. So anyway, from there, I went and seen fucking Spider-Man. Spider-Man said, oh, Spider-Man gets a picture with Spider-Man.
This is all like them cartoon characters on Hollywood Boulevard, yeah, right? So it's people in suits.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah. So people in suits, I should explain that. So it's next to where all the stars are on the streets and all that.
Yeah.
So it's Spider-Man. Oh, so he gets a picture with Spider-Man and he says, can I pick her up? I went, yeah, pick her up. She's only three. Pick her up. And she's all like buzzing and all that. So give him $3. He went, what the fuck's that? I said, what do you mean? That's what he said. He went, come on, man. Where are you from? I said, I'm from England. He went, yeah, it's not fucking 1980. What the fuck's that? give me $10. I went, I haven't got $10. He went, I'll give you a change. I'm like, no, mate. There's $3, you can get that. So I said, Livy, I know the score. You know, so this is what they must do to tourists to try and get
one over. Yeah, yeah.
Like, cheeky bastard, Spider-Man. I was getting angry because Spider-Man was in my face.
Was he a big fella?
Not really. I was smashed his head in, Spider-Man or not. You know what I mean?
This is a great story.
I couldn't believe it. Anyway, so I give him the $3. I give him the $3 I got off Minnie Mouse. So went for food and all that, done all the touristy shit. Went down to pay for the valet parking. I give the fella a $20 bill, and he's got his pen out, roared, and that's a fake. When you're fucking joking.
This is from the change from Spider-Man.
This is from the change from Minnie Mouse.
Oh, from Minnie Mouse.
So Minnie Mouse on Hollywood Boulevard
just giving you fake.
Just fucked us off with a $20 bill. I remember that was just like an hour ago.
So what happened at the valet parking?
So I gotta give him a bigger note and get him to split up. But he gives us a back. Now I've got this $20 bill and I'm absolutely sick because I'm you know the phrase you can't kid a kidder.
Yeah.
I think I'm a kidder. I've spent dodgy money before and all that when I was younger. And I've just been had.
Got screwed.
But by Minnie Mouse. Minnie Mouse. And it's funny because when she was putting the money in her pocket, I had my phone, I was doing a little video. I thought, oh, because she had a big fat wad of money. I was like, ah, look at that. That's a good picture. So like I said, I'll put that on boxlifepodcast.com/69. You'll be able to see that there.
That's interesting. That I wonder how many people get screwed like that on a daily basis because there's thousands of people up and down that street every day doing that touristy shit. And probably just getting screwed and getting given fake money. You know, all day.
And the good thing for them about doing that is that, like, 99 times out of 100, they're not going to see that person again because they're here on holiday.
Yeah.
You know, and then there's the lads giving out the CDs. Have you seen them?
Oh yeah, they're when so you walk annoying.
Yeah, hey, have a CD. It's free. It's my music. I've made it. And you're like, oh,
they're pushy as fuck. As pushy. Well. Like, I don't want your CD. I'm all right.
They give you the CD.
Have the CD.
Put the headphones on.
It's
your
like
head.
Who listens to a CD now?
Right.
I don't even have anything to put a CD into. Not even my laptop has a CD drive on it. No.
Yeah, they'll be going out of business soon. Yeah. So they push it in here. Here's my CD, headphones on you. You're like, fuck, do you like my music? Yeah, yeah, CD's free. I just want a tip.
Yeah.
And it's the same, like,
yeah.
If you give them fucking $2?
You listen to it, they force you to listen to it for like 20 seconds and then it's charged you for that 20 seconds of time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But they make you feel so uncomfortable as well.
And that is as if anyone's ever going to get a record deal or get anywhere out by doing that.
But I bet you they're making dope by doing it.
I doubt it.
Right?
I don't think Spider-Man's making dope. Have you not noticed all them characters on Hollywood Boulevard as well? They're all like scruffy people and their suits are really like shit.
They're really dirty.
They're really unclean.
I've seen this story on there about on Facebook. People might have seen this, and if not, we'll put that in the show notes as well. We'll try and find on YouTube about Superman who'd been there for like 25 years. Yeah. He was a ringer. He looked exactly like
I've seen him.
Have you seen him?
I've seen him, yeah. Because I went to a college on Hollywood Boulevard, so I was up and down there every day for 6 months when I first got here.
All the time.
Yeah.
So you see how much he looks like him. It's like, whoa, you've got to look twice because it's absolutely amazing. He's got a mask on. He's that perfect. And his teeth is, I don't remember his teeth, they're like perfectly white teeth.
Well, and like the curl and all that.
Exactly, it's perfect. Well, he got beat up, and I think they smashed his teeth in as well. And they took everything off him.
Why am I laughing at that?
Oh, miss. This is bread and butter. It's like someone smashing you with a wrist. You kind of working
on it. I know, it's all.
And it was really upset, and I think they're going to fund me or something to raise money for him.
Wow.
But it was so sad.
Shit, that's horrible. but I just remember them suits being really horrible. Like, they're like dirty and shit. And I'm like, I think the people in them are just, you know, like, homeless or well, not homeless, but like, you know what I mean?
I wonder if you need a license there, because I'm telling you, them's making dough. If I was a shitty tourist, I would have given at least $5. If you try to rape us with 10, I would have given $5.
Right.
You know?
I actually used to train a guy in all them touristy shops that have got I Love Hollywood, I Love LA, that just proper junk shit. I trained a guy who owns all of those and all the Vegas ones.
All of them?
He's about 26 and he's a multimillionaire.
Bloody hell.
And my wife used to cut his hair, that's how I started training him. And she said to him, what do you do? And he goes, I sell shit. She's like, well, what are you doing? He's like, no, I sell junk. That's what I'm in the business of. So all those touristy shops in Vegas and on the Strip in Hollywood and all that, he owns all of them.
Wow.
He's got them all down. And I was wondering if them cartoon characters who stand on the street and stuff, if they're all run by like an agency or a company or something. I don't think they're just random people that have put a suit on.
Well, that business,
there's got to be some sort of restriction.
That business that you're talking about, like your fella makes, it is shit. Like, today I was looking there and they've got...
But it makes a fortune.
Yeah, they've got the like Oscar-looking plastic awards. And it's like the world's best dad, the world's best mum, the world's best niece and all that.
Yeah.
For all the tourists to buy.
Yeah.
And they're like $20 each. They must cost them like something you expect to get from the 99 cent store.
Yeah.
You
know? There's a business model. It's brilliant.
So good. Like, as well in LA, what you can do, you can sell these T-shirts everywhere, like I Love LA and all of the ones with the pot on and all that shit and Donald Trump and all that.
Yeah.
And the tourists go mad for them and they buy them down Venice Beach and everywhere. And you can go down to downtown LA. There's like a bit of a ghetto part in downtown LA. Have you been there yet? Where it's like the shopping district. It's called the fashion district.
Oh, like the fashion district. And like there's the arts district, the fashion district. There's a bunch of different districts.
And it's like being in Thailand where they're selling all the snide gear, but it's not so much snide. It's where you can buy these T-shirts. You can buy like 10 for $10.
Wasn't the American Apparel store in that area? Yeah, I know what you mean.
It was right down there.
Yeah, yeah.
But with these T-shirts that they're selling at Venice Beach for $30 each, you can go down there and get 10 for $10.
Yeah.
Because the quality is just shit.
Yeah.
So that's the kind of same thing with these awards and these things that are selling in the shops. Tourists go mad for them.
I know, it's mad. That's what I don't get. It's like, what you'd think who buys this stuff, but then just walk down Hollywood Boulevard and you're like, oh,
when I first come here, I would buy it because you come here and it's like, you're in Los Angeles.
Yeah, you're only
Hollywood
here for a short period of time.
You need a souvenir because you can't believe you've seen the Hollywood sign.
Yeah.
You know? And like just there, I've done a little Instagram story of the Hollywood sign. Even now, I've been here just over 5 years, even when I see the Hollywood sign, I'm like, shit.
Yeah.
I live here.
I got over that stuff quick though, me. Hollywood.
Do you?
Yeah, I can't stand Hollywood. It does my head in. I just think it's dirty and packed and it's just so overrated. People come to LA and think, I've got to see the Hollywood sign, I've got to go to Hollywood and go up and down Hollywood Boulevard and Sunset and all that. I'm like, so much better shit than to LA.
See, I disagree. I'm one of them people who love that shit. Like, I buzz off that, like, whoa, look, it's the Hollywood sign. You know, I love it, and I can see why other people do.
It's just soup. It's just proper tacky. It's like,
but it is to us because we've lived here for so long. But I did be surprised. I did get surprised when I first came to LA and I seen how shit Hollywood was. Because I was expecting it to be like Rodeo Drive. Yeah, Beverly Hills. And I was like, wow, Hollywood's
See, that's worth it. Going to.
Yeah.
Go down there. Right. That's next level.
And when we were driving back, I was just driving through Beverly Hills. And again, it's like, wow, I live here. You see the Beverly Hills sign, like you see off Beverly Hills Cop when we were kids. And all the massive houses. And I was telling Jack and Henry about like all the celebrities living in these houses. Like, ridiculous. Yeah. I was talking about with Sarah, my wife, when we're driving back, was I wonder if it's like I can see now why people rent here rather than buy, because if you don't know this and you're from the UK and you listen to this, where we pay council tax, these pay property tax. They pay 1.1 or 1.2% of the value of the house each year in tax.
Yeah.
And down these streets in Beverly Hills, you can't get a house for less than $5-10 million. So if you own a $10 million house, now you've got to pay $120,000 a year property tax.
Yeah.
That's $10,000 a month property tax.
Yeah.
So I was saying to Sarah, like, I wonder if it is worth buying a house. It, obviously, she said, well, if you've got $10 million to buy a house, $120,000 a year is nothing.
Yeah.
But what I was thinking was, is it better to rent? Because when you're renting, now that's part of your tax write-off.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, a lot of people slag off renting because they're like, oh, you're just throwing your money away, it's dead money, it's not an investment.
Right. But
in LA, it's to get, just to give anyone who's outside of LA a picture, it's like to get a decent modern house to own in a good area is like a lifetime of work to get to that point.
Oh, yeah.
So you've got not much option. So I'd rather rent a decent spot, in a decent gaff in a decent area while you're doing all right,
right,
and then try and build towards that later on. A lot of people are like, I've got to own. But I don't know. It's just different people like different things. But I'm not really like that. But it's interesting you mentioned about the property tax, because I was just talking to one of our friends, Paul King, who's been on this podcast in the past about that, and he was telling me his rents or his mortgage on his house that he built himself is a certain amount, and then the property tax that he pays on top of that was like almost a quarter of that mortgage payment. But he pays it annually. He pays a property tax annually. And it's just like, if you add that on top of the mortgage payment, it's like, it's almost like doubling your mortgage payment. People forget that. It's like, oh, it's only going to cost me this much, but then throwing the property tax, like, shit. It's like,
if you, when you said, people see before, like, I've said it before, I'll win $10 million, I'll buy a house in Beverly Hills.
Yeah.
Yeah, but now you need $10,000 a month. Just your property tax.
To have it.
Not even anything else.
Yeah.
No, it's mad. How much is it? I remember when I was first over here, and me and Kev were going to business boxing bill with Mickey Rock. We went to Mickey Rock's house. He lived in one of them big houses in Beverly Hills. This was like 6 years ago, and his missus, Anna, she was a model. I don't know if this was together or not, his girlfriend. I was like, wow, this house is amazing. And she told us, she went, oh, he gets a great deal on the rent. I'm like, all right, how much? $16,000 a month.
So he rented that?
He rented it.
Yeah.
That's when I was like, why the fuck would you pay $16,000 a month?
Do you remember Michael Jackson was renting his house on Sunset Boulevard, the one that he died in?
Oh, right.
Was it like, I think, $100,000 a month?
Yeah. You see them when you look on magazines for $100,000 a month and that, it's like, whoa.
Yeah.
But
then you're like, why wouldn't you buy? But then think of property tax. That's probably why.
That's going to be $100,000 a month, right? And when you're a celebrity, like Mickey Rourke moving about and all that, you know. Mm. But it was funny because he was paying like $16,000 a month rent for his house. Back then, when I come over here, I thought that was ridiculous. I mean, now we've got friends who pay that, you know. And
well, you pay that on the Brentwood gym.
We pay more than that,
yeah.
But that's for a business, you know.
Yeah.
But people are paying this, and when I first came, I was like, "Wow!" But now we've got people. We know people who's doing that. It's mad, but like I said, I can see why they're doing it, and the value of the property over here has just went up through the roof. And me and Kev were talking on the last podcast on episode 68 about how I was driving down Montana the other day, and all these businesses closed down. But I can see why they're closing down, because the rent's going up through the roof.
Yeah,
you know. I heard that the Chinese are buying all the places in LA,
which is
mad, you know, for investments to get green cards and
all that. Yeah,
yeah. And all these businesses.
What I heard is what's happening. There's a trend of people from outside the country, like you said, China, buying properties in specifically in LA.
Yeah.
And just leaving them there.
Yeah.
No one's living in them. they're just buying them, and they're just kind of sitting around.
Yeah, I've heard they've like fucked San Francisco because they're doing it even more up there, and you can't even rent a place now up there because they've bought them all and they're not even living in them, you know. And that, I mean, but like I said, the rent on locations, it's so hard to run a business here. We try harder than most people to run a business, and it's so tough. And as well, not just the rent, is the fucking arseholes in LA. Like me and Kev were caught the other day.
Yeah.
Some arsehole trying to sue us for something ridiculous, you know.
That's the culture in it. It's like I think someone said to me the other day, you've not owned a business, or you've not lived or owned a business in LA if you haven't been sued yet.
Yeah, it's kind of like yourself. It's kind of like if you've not been a playboy and actually put an STD.
Yeah.
But we were in court sitting there like for a full day, and we never even got seen. We got adjourned, and I can't see right now what it was for. But as soon as this, we've got to go back in November. But as soon as it's over, I'll be able to talk all about it. And then as well, we've been trying to get sued for something else. A locker like went over on a girl and never heard it. I don't know. So that, and then the other thing we've spoken about in the podcast before, when we got sued for putting a Mayweather fight on there. But we only ended up paying $5,000 for that, when they told us it was going to be $250,000.
Yeah.
So if we're getting people trying to sue us all the time, which we haven't had to close down yet, I can see why these businesses are closing down.
Right.
Because you've got these arseholes. Like, where are we from in England? I don't think I know anyone who sued anyone for something like that. It's like, oh shit.
We just sort our shit out, don't we?
I know.
Just kinda get
and that's what I was saying to Kev about this one the other day. Like, if it was in England, it would have been handled a different way.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Like, men were talking out. We're like, all right, this is what happens.
It's really weird. It's like when it's the same with, like, on the street or whatever, if you get into an argument with someone.
Yeah.
Like, we're used to, like, you fight or you don't fight, or you just sort it out.
Yeah.
And it's like the minute someone's slightly threatened or intimidated here, it's like, boom, phone's out, 911.
Yeah.
Calling the cops, calling. Do you know what I mean? It's like, they just let the courts and the police handle everything, all the business for them.
It's so scary over here because you kind of do a thing.
Yeah.
A thing, like, because of that shit. I mean, I guess it's safer. This morning, I'm driving.
I learned that lesson pretty quick.
Your road rage and all that.
Yeah. Well, 2007 or 2008, I got arrested. I got into a fight in a bar.
But that's not road rage.
No, that was a separate incident. But I got arrested for fighting. Well, technically, I got arrested for drunk in public and resisting arrest. We got into a fight, hit a guy in a bar. And then he scarped with his missus. By the time the police had come, they'd gone. They arrested my mate, who I was with, took him outside, put him on the floor in cuffs, right? He's down, face down on the floor in cuffs. And then I ran outside, saw him on the floor, and they tasered him while he still had handcuffs on.
No.
Yeah. Tev.
Oh, Tev?
Yeah. So he's there in agony on the floor being tasered, and it just, like, it sent me into, like, I just lost control because I've been drinking, but I saw him in agony, and I was like, you pussies, you know what I mean?
To the police?
I just ran up to him. I went, what the fuck are you doing to him like this? I'm like, get off him like this. Oh. And then I was just like, head down on the police car, arrested.
Wow. So scary.
It was, at the time, I was scared as shit, and the handcuffs was so tight they cut right into my wrist and left, like, they cut all open on my wrist here. I had a big cut on my wrist, still got a scar from it. And the cop who was driving us to the police station was just an asshole. My wife came to the police car while I was in the back of the car saying, it's all right, he's with me, I can take him home, it's all right, everything's fine. He's going, nope, he's going to jail. Dude. just assholes. And then we actually had a funny night in the cell because we were in the next door to each other in the cell. So we just stayed up all night having banter and taking the piss and stuff. But when we at the time coming out, it was scary because we hadn't got full citizenship or anything like that. We were still on green cards. And we're like, shit, we could get deported. They could take that off us. It was really scary. And we got lawyers involved and hired them to protect us, and ended up getting it reduced to like a noise ticket.
Right.
So we only had to pay a small fine. But the best part was, the funny side of it was, we had to go and do 15 AA meetings.
Oh.
So we had to go and do AA meetings every week, which we had some fun with. And then it came out in the local newspaper, like the area we were in. It was like, two youths were arrested this weekend. These were the first two youths to be arrested for drunk in public and resisting arrest in this town for 10 years. And we saw that and we were like, get it. Like a badge of honour.
Hashtag English.
Yeah. Once we knew we got away with it, we seen the news story and all that. We're like, oh, result.
Well, that's the thing with the police over here, where they've got them guns, you know, and I can't tell you how afraid I am of guns. And I'm in a coffee shop and you see them and I'm this close to the police's gun.
And it's just right there in his pocket.
It's just there.
Yeah.
And that shit, it's supposed to keep you safe or whatever. That shit scares me more than anything,
yeah.
A gun. I was on the, what's called the Wardcast podcast with Scott, and I was doing it in his house. Scott is a SWAT guy. I'm going to get him on this show soon. He works for Santa Monica SWAT team. Proper badass. Cop, like you can see he is. And when we're in his house, in his garage, he was like, oh, and I've got things stashed away everywhere. And I was like, what do you mean? And he just pulled something from underneath the desk, fucking gun.
Fucking
hell. And I was like, and he went, is it loaded? He went, sure as the bullets. I was like, shit, I got nervous. My heart started beating fast. And he went, here, I've got a fucking, what's them baton things called? Got one of these, another gun here, knife here, knife.
Shit.
I'm like, whoa. This motherfucker was prepared.
But did you not think, right, if you want to talk about on a big picture, the country lives in kind of, there's like an underlying fear and a paranoia. It's like, I've got to have a gun in case shit goes wrong. I've got to protect myself.
Right.
Like, we don't think like that.
No.
I don't live in fear that shit's going to go wrong.
If I had a gun in this house, I would be more fearful.
Right.
I would be on the back of my mind all the time. There's a gun. If it's stashed in a safe or wherever, there's a gun there. That's, you know, that scares me.
We know firsthand as well through someone who used to work at the gym who shot themselves like 2 years ago.
One of our trainers committed suicide.
There was a gun in the house. It's just like, if that wasn't there.
Got drunk one night on downer with drugs or whatever. I don't know if that's the case, but this is what happens. And next thing, blasted his cell away. Yeah. So, it's shit like that. And if we could talk to them, I'm not using Brandon as just as an example, but like, because I don't know the full situation behind that, but I know this shit happens with other people. It's scary. If the gun wasn't there, they had to take tablets to try and kill themselves. They don't kill themselves, go to hospital. Now they look like an arsehole. I've had close family to me do that.
Yeah.
If they had a gun, they would be fucking dead right now.
Yeah, yeah.
But now, because I'd never had a gun, that had things to slit the wrists, what never worked, or they had tablets, and they went to hospital, they got fixed, now they're still alive. Like I say, this is close family to me. So that's the benefit of not having guns,
because
they'd be fucking brown dead, brown bread right now.
Yeah, yeah.
No?
It's interesting. So we've gone, right, from...
Well, let's talk about the what we were talking about there, about not having to hold back from people because we're scared of the police. This morning, I'm driving down what's it called, Colorado Boulevard, next to the gym, on the way back from the gym, going home before the charity class. There's some fucking clown on a bike. By the way, if you cyclists are the biggest arseholes.
Don't even get me started on this.
Cyclists, mate. But
don't even get me started.
So let me tell you something about cyclists.
We could do a whole separate podcast just on how much I hate cyclists.
So the type of people, if you open your door, when they're driving past, they shout, oh, they call you arseholes. Anyway, this dickhead is in front of us. It's a massive two-lane road, and he's kind of, well, it's like a lane and a half. Like a lean on a bike lane, it's just been done.
Just so people know, in a lot of LA, there's a designated bike lane. Though.
Right. This wasn't a bike lane. It was weird. It was like a road, but it had a big lane there, but it wasn't bikes. And I'm driving up, and he's there, and he gnaws on behind him, and he's just taking his time.
Yeah.
And the fucking roads are empty.
Yeah.
There's no other cars around. And I'm there, and I'm thinking, come on, Dick. Come on, Dick. But I'm not. But I'm keeping me cool. I've got Jack in the car. He's laughing his head off. So I beep start on. Beep, beep. And the cyclist, you know, they get road rage.
Straight away, yeah.
Boom, snapped.
The ego goes through the roof.
Hands in the air. Yeah. So I'm like, I'm going to wind this cunt up. So I'm beep, 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 beep. He's gone mad. Beep, beep, beep. On the horn. Mitty's gone mad. Jack gets his phone out and videos it. Tell you what, I'll get this video. I'll put it on boxnightpodcast.com/69 I'll get the video on there. Y'all see it. It's funny. And he's fuming, this guy. He pulls his phone out of his pocket while he's riding the bike, turns around, takes pictures of me cars. Yeah. This is on the video as well. And I'm like, you little prick, come on, move. Just move to the side. And then we get to the traffic lights, and then there's a car in front of us, and he's there. I'm like, will you move, mate? Will you move? And he's like, you can't go anywhere. There's nowhere to go. I'm like, I cannot. I'm trying to go home. And anyway, then he moves off. Eventually, after the traffic lights, I drive past him and I pull up next to him. I'm like, mate, what are you doing? What's all that about? He went, see, you can't get anywhere faster. You've got to wait for the traffic lights anyway. I'm like, no, mate. I said, you should fucking move out of the way.
Yeah.
Why you not move to the side? And he went, there's not a bike lane here. I went, just move to the side. Anyway. And then I drive off and he goes on the path and drives the path.
Yeah.
I've been following him for fucking 5 minutes and he's not even wanting to be on the road anyway.
Yeah.
Like, you little bell end.
They wind me up so much with they've always got them like the what. So there's like, I think like two different schools of cyclists. There's just people who are on a bike just getting about.
Right.
And then there's cyclists who've got the helmet, the tight gear.
Yeah.
No ass. Saggy little ass.
The shoes.
Little fat belly, them horrible shoes. And when they walk into a shop next to you, I'm going, the shoes are loud just as fuck.
Clicking.
Like. Yeah.
Yeah.
They're like just horrible people. They're just like arrogant as fuck. Think they own the road, right? You never see them stop at a stop sign or a traffic light. They just do what they want. And then they just think they own the road and that they can drive or they can cycle in the regular lanes.
Right.
You know, they just think they own the place. Remember one time I was driving back when I was coming from Hollywood one time. It was the same sort of thing, just in the middle of like Hollywood Boulevard or what it was, just cycling like this. For fuck's sake. And I was trying to get him to move over, right? And he same exact situation. He's like shouting at me. He's going, you can't get past. And I went, he's like, we have rights on the road as well. I went, oh, you do you, right? I went, well, follow me onto the freeway. Let's see how you do on there. Dad's just like, you know, what are you going to do? You can't go, you know, you're talking
the
shit.
The little pricks. The thing is, I'm hard as fuck. I'm hard as fuck. I'm not scared. Especially a little prick on a bike. So I just thought, please get off your bike.
Yeah.
And I don't know what you said about that. Please get off your bike. I'll get out the car. Let's see what happens.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
You know what'll happen is exactly what we just talked about before.
Because I'll just
he'll pull out his phone and ring the cops.
Yeah, I mean, I'd love it because